I'm Kim Audette. I also work in the education department, and I am an academic advisor, an adjunct instructor, and my special niche is working with the workforce. So people who are already in the field who want to come back to school or continue on. And I'm going to let each of us introduce ourselves. So Kathy?
I'm Kathy with the transfer office, so I'll be doing the last half of the 7 slides to talk a little bit about transfer.
I'm Lou Pugh. I work in the advising center with education majors and health science and health occupation students primarily. So my role at GCC is an advisor.
Hi, I'm Cindy So. I work with peer tutoring. I coordinate the writing and language tutors and teach in the language in the English department. And I have some advisees who are doing LEO, so that's why I'm here.
Hint, if you can't find Peggy or myself, if you ever have questions, these are the guys to go talk to. And they are here in this building in the advising center, where Peggy and I are over in the East Building in our division. So we did our quick introductions. We're going to be talking a little bit about what education a la GCC is like, because as if you've been to other schools, every school has, you know, slight differences in their degree programs. So we want to talk a little bit about that here. The career and educational pathways that you can take with an education degree from GCC. Transfer, again, things to consider, and Kathy has probably more information than Fort Knox has gold in that head of hers. We're going to talk a little bit about professional development and advanced degrees, so what happens after you get your four-year degree or your associate's degree and go out to work in the field. Then we're going to have you guys take a little walk about our room, where we're going to have you do a little problem solving for yourself. What are the steps you need to take? And then at the end, we'll talk about some questions, any resources, and you can make dates with any of us to talk more. So we want to talk a little bit about the career pathways, because some of you may have come in and said, okay, I want to work with kids, or I want to work with high schoolers, but really didn't have the clearest idea of all the options that are available for working with those ages. So there is your typical education degree, which might lead to being a teacher in the public school. Our early childhood degree might lead you to working in community programs like Head Start, like the Y, like All About Learning, and some of our more private programs. You can also start in one position, how many of us have done it through the years, and you might, let's say, start in first grade, but then you say, oh, I really like reading, and I really like literacy, so I'm going to go on and become a reading specialist. The other big point is, especially in education, learning does not end with your associate's, your bachelor's, or even your master's, or your PhD. In all our fields, there is something called continuing education, where we want you to continue to learn, to stay updated in the field, and all the different fields require different number of hours and different ways to do that. So you are starting as a lifelong learner. Actually, you've probably started that way before now, but you are going to continue as a lifelong learner. So this is Peggy, who is the coordinator of vision here at GCC.
And I'm just going to go over and just give you a little snippet into like an overall philosophy, an approach to this idea of teaching and learning on a big sort of grand scale. And so the education department has 10 core principles. I'm not sure if it's included in your handouts or not, but that shape our approach to teaching and learning and shape our curriculum and our philosophy of working with all of you as students in the education field. So we believe, one of our core principles is we believe that learning is a multi-directional process, not a linear path to correct answers. So teaching and learning is a very complex, interactive process. We believe that curiosity is a seriously important academic and professional attitude. And that includes if you're teaching the little ones, who we know are intrinsically curious and wanting to know all about their world. And we believe that that love of curiosity should continue all the way through elementary school, high school, college. We want you to come to our classes being curious. Actually, one of the questions on my curriculum planning guide for teachers is, what are you curious about when you're planning a guide, a curriculum guide in your classroom? So anyway, so we want to give you just a little window into sort of what that type of thinking might look like. And on your tables now. We're distributed a couple small containers. There's a scent, there's a smell in each of them. So before you open them, I want to tell you, they're essential oils. If you are scent sensitive and don't want to smell it, that's fine. You don't have to. There's nothing gross or icky or like weird scents in there. You're not going to like smell and be like, I can't believe she made us smell this. No, but I just want you to take a moment and just open them up and just take a little smell and then just have a react. So this is actually based on something that one of our student teachers did with young children, a project. They invited children to smell, and they wanted them to explore the idea of smell. And one of the questions they asked young children is, when you smell, does something go inside your body? So if I ask that to you, how would you respond? When you smell, does something go inside your body? Some people are nodding yes. Yeah? Okay. And then we could take, and so you can think about how 3-year-olds might answer that question, and how a 10-year-old might answer that question, or a 16-year-old might answer that question, and what kind of knowledge they might have, and how that would be an interesting thing to hook teaching and learning around. And what goes into your body? Well, how do you know it goes into your body? We can't see it. What does it look like? Where does it go then? How do you know? How can you tell what it is? You're looking at it. It smells like lemon, but you don't see a lemon. How do you know it's a lemon? So all these things that we engage from, that we believe are an important process of teaching and learning. And some of the children's theories, which I know you are really dying to know, it stops on your nose. It goes in your nose and comes back out on the table. It goes in your nose and stops right here at the bridge part. It goes in your nose and comes out when you sneeze. And then we ask them to think about that more. We had discussions. We asked them to communicate their ideas more by giving them actually pictures of noses and pictures of a body for them to look at. And they revised their theories about what happens listening to each other talk. We keep taking this idea and exploring it deeper and deeper with the children over time to sort of build their knowledge, because the process of smelling can be a little bit magical, as well as very scientific. And so those are kind of those, just a little glimpse into how we like to approach our overall thinking about the business of teaching and learning together. So shifting a little bit, and I think in your handouts you have something with an image on it that says, what's your vision? So I'm going to invite you just to take a moment. What's your vision? So you're here to think about, how do you proceed in education? Where's my path? And what do I want to do? And part of that is just taking a moment to think about, what draws you to the field of education in the first place? Why do you want to be in this career? What do you think is interesting about it? What do you hope to get out of it? What do you hope to, what purpose do you bring to it? And then what setting do you see yourself working in overall? So when you do imagine yourself being the teacher in a classroom, in the public school, in a fairly traditional classroom of elementary students or high school students, or I see myself in a really progressive private center that's doing some really innovative and way kind of crazy out there type of stuff with young children. Just take a moment to think about some of that and jot down some of your thoughts. This isn't a test. Nobody's going to look at it. This is for you to think about it. And as we go along, you can kind of refer back to that.
And as people who have started our program before know that we really focus on what you bring to the class, and then we hang new ideas on those so that you can grow your knowledge and grow your skill level. So it's always a good thing to start with, where are you at now? What are you thinking? And we are going to come back to this, so don't worry about it. I want to talk a little bit about all the options in the field that I alluded to earlier. The first group that we usually see are people who want to work in early childhood education. And in early childhood, it includes teaching in community-based programs. Mentioned before, it's birth to 6 years old, unless the child has special needs and needs to stay back a while until they catch up on their skills. So that might be the Head Starts, the Y, the other programs that people used to refer to just as daycare programs. Then we have family child care, where you're taking care of children in your home. And it's a whole nother license, but it's also under the Department of Early Education and Care. And those children can be age birth up through school, usually elementary school. So those, the elementary school children could come after school. So they may be in public school during the day or private school and then come to you for the 3 to 6 until parents get out of work. Early intervention are the people who work with the children birth through 3. So before they're picked up by the public schools. And they're usually children who have been identified by parents or doctors or social workers in that first year or two of life where they have some concerns, whether they were premature, whether they were born with physical disability or intellectual disability, could be hearing disability. It's one of the things I do to keep myself focused with children, and I love it. And under developmental specialists, there are also occupational therapists, physical therapists, language therapists, social workers, nurses, who all really work to make a safety net for our littlest people because we know so much happens during those first 3 years of life. Along with that, there's a new specialty, autism specialists, because as many of you may know, the incidence of autism has increased dramatically over the last couple of years, and it's now like 1 in 68 children are born with some kind of autism. So we're seeing it at the earliest stages, and the elementary schools and high schools are really starting to see the influx. So there's almost a whole specialty around that. Under community-based care, there are lots of positions above your basic level teacher. There's the director, an educational coordinator, who is somebody who's overseeing the curriculum component maybe for multiple sites. There are out-of-school time group leaders, which most of you probably think of as after school. But the new term out-of-school wraps around not just after school, but camp and summer programs, and also before school care. So, and they usually pick up children from kindergarten up through high school. And we have an out-of-school time program at Greenfield High right now that's doing lots of more specialty work. There's a family child care supervisor who may be part of a huge organization who goes out and works with all the family child care providers. Family supporter, a family advocate who works directly with families. And this is a big position with Head Starts, where we know that the family needs some help as well as the child. Resource and referral specialist, somebody who's there for parents or other agencies who can say, okay, here's a place in the field, here's a resource for you, here's how to get some support for paying for childcare. There are people who do just professional development, which is more training and that continuing ed piece. The colleges were doing the whole education, the theory. This is general to specific to kids, and these professional development consultants will speak specifically about one area of how you can continue to grow your expertise. And then there are quality improvement specialists which come out and help the program. And they work with individuals within a program to move the whole program up. So those are all positions in the field, in the community-based field. And then we have career options in the field of education in the more public school arena. And this includes elementary and secondary education. And even within there, there are specialties. There is a pre-K through second grade. So that is starting at 4 years old and going up through second grade. But there's also still a license that's elementary, which is first grade up through 6. So there's some overlap. Then there's middle and secondary grades. Again, there are the regular classroom teachers who are the primary educators for those kids, but they're also subject focused. There's a reading and language arts specialist. There are math and science, the STEM areas, engineering teachers. There's history and music, so your subject areas. And especially in middle and high school, that's where those start really kicking in, although there are some specialists for the younger elementary grades as well. There are instructors of the special populations, your special ed, your English language learners. And then there are also paraprofessionals and assistant teachers and tutors. And then as you're in the system, moving on up, gain more education and expertise. School guidance or adjustment counselors who are working with children and families within the school environment. There are department chairs of many of the departments, so you may be the chair of the STEM department, so you're overseeing all the instructors for science and math and engineering. There are behaviorists and psychologists, crisis interventionist specialists to work individually with children
as well as small groups who are experiencing difficulties and challenges. Again, your administrators, your principals, there are consultants who come in and work on specific areas. These days, we're seeing a lot of yoga and mindfulness consultants coming in to help work in classrooms. And this is kind of a hot topic these days. And they're finding some really good results for helping staff and children learn how to self-regulate. There are, again, professional development specialists. If you're in the public schools, you're going to have professional development days where you're not seeing children. You are working with your peers around specific topics that are an issue at your school. And then there are coaches. And we didn't want to leave out, with an education degree, people also move into some of the human service and public health fields because they interact. Social workers and therapists. You can be a family therapist or a child therapist or adolescent therapist, and you may be working with the schools. So having an idea and having that expertise in the education system allows you to make that flow work better. And there are child life specialists who work in the hospitals. There are, again, family advocates, your OTs, your physical therapists, your speech therapists, arts and recreation therapists who may come into the school or may work separately, your mental health counselors. We have child specialists twice. That's a really good feel. Think about that. It's something I kind of experimented with when I was looking to continue my degree, and it's so needed and such a really, you need to be a very special person to do that. There are autism and ABA specialists, and ABA is applied behavior analysis, which is a specific kind of work that you do to work with children with autism that they have found to be successful with many of the children. And there are also court-appointed special advocates where you're the person going to court and working with the judge and the lawyers to make sure the needs of that child are being met, even as their parents might be going through a divorce or they may be in the foster care system, and the system may say, all right, you're 18, you're aged out, go live on your own. And you might be the person there helping to say, no, this young adult needs more, and they need other supports to make it. So another really great one.
After all of that, you know exactly what you're going to do, right? You know what you're going to do, you know what you're going to be, and you gotta it feels like a lot. There's so many possibilities, and we're just like, whew. So, okay. There's that. How do you get from where you are right now here to where you want to go? First things first. First things to think about. What ages do I want to work with? We've got all the way from infant toddlers through high school. What ages do I want to work with? Second thing you want to think about, what type of setting? Community-based settings, public school, or with some other types of organizations. In the medical field, a hospital organization, early intervention, do you want to open your own family childcare? All of those are the different types of settings that you might want to work in. Those are the places you want to start, the first questions you need to ask yourself, and you may already have the answers to those questions. So we're moving into, what's your educational pathway look like for what your decision is and where you want to get to? So GCC has two education options in our department. We have an Associate's of Science degree in Early Childhood Education, which is known as the ECE. We have an Associate's of Arts degree in Liberal Arts Education option, which is called the LEO. Two different programs. Both programs fulfill requirements to transfer to a four-year institution. So, again, remember those two first basic questions. The ECE degree, I want to work with children birth through age 6, and I see myself working in community-based programs. Those are essentially anything that doesn't fall under the public school realm. I want to work with the youngest children. I want to work closely with families. I see myself not in the public school system. The ECE degree prepares you with the requirements for what's known as a teacher and lead teacher certification from the state. So when you complete a 2-year ECE degree here, you can apply to the state for your lead teacher certification in preschool, infant toddler preschool certification. You may also transfer to a bachelor's degree program in early education and care. But after those first 2 years, you are eligible to go out into the field and to get a job in early education and care, meeting basic requirements. Some programs will require lead teachers to have a bachelor's degree or to be working towards their bachelor's degree. So we strongly encourage students to keep that in the back of their mind. Maybe they want to go out in the field for a little bit, but keep in mind that bachelor's degree option because it really positions you for some of the best positions in this field. The LEO degree. I see myself pre-K, this is a wide range, right? Anywhere from pre-K all the way through high school. I really see myself in the public school system. I want to be a public school teacher. This is a place for you. What this program does is prepare you to transfer. So you see here, you may transfer to a four-year institution, but you don't have to. You can go right into the field and teach. If you're going to public school, after the 2 years at GCC, you must transfer to a four-year degree for your to get a bachelor's degree in order to get teacher licensure. So when you complete your bachelor's degree in an education program, then you apply to the state for your licensure, teacher licensure. And that throughout this process, you'll choose, and Kim mentioned the license are divided into different areas. There's pre-K through second grade. You get a license for pre-K through second grade. Or you get a license for first through sixth grade. Or you get licensed through 5 through 12. So there are different license options. So when you complete an ECE degree at GCC, you will be completing 60 to 61 credits, include at least 31 directly related to education. You complete your general ed requirements. Those are the things that allow you to transfer to a four-year institution. And you complete 2 semesters of student teaching, which is 150 hours in the field practicum each semester. And there's a placement process, and you attend a seminar with that. So you get quite a bit of in-the-field experience. Again, certification and licensure, two different things. Sometimes people incorrectly use those terms and it gets confusing. Certification, early childhood community-based, licensure, public school. The LEO degree. Here it's broken down into those licensure categories we mentioned and teaching in the public schools. When you complete the LEO degree here, the program includes 60 to 61 credits, at least 9 credits directly related to education, general education requirements. The big difference here, remember you must transfer to a four-year institution and you're preparing to transfer, and you'll need to choose when you transfer to the four-year institution, you're essentially carrying 2 degrees. You're carrying your education degree, major degree, and a second degree of your choice, which is usually something in the humanities field, depending on what level you're looking at, like psychology, or what are some other common ones? Sociology, psychology, communication, yeah, history and English, depending on where you're at. So, you have to sort of like double major. So what we're doing at GCC is helping you decide what might be, we call it here an area of concentration, because you're not double majoring here. But you're saying, oh, I think my second degree when I get to the 4 year is going to be psychology. I'm working with young children. Psychology would be a good, I'd get some good information with that. So here at GCC, what psychology courses would be right for you to take to prepare you and already give you some beginning credits to transfer to your 4 year institution and get you in at a junior level? So we prepare you for that here. If you're thinking, I want to be an English teacher for eighth grade, your area of concentration here would be English, or history, if you're thinking, I really want to be that history teacher in high school. But you're also getting some basic foundational courses in education and what that whole teaching and learning process means. So this degree is really designed to do that. And then to prepare you to take the first part of something called the Massachusetts Tests for Educator Licensure, otherwise known as the MTEL. How many of you have heard about the MTEL? Know about it? Anybody taking it? No? Okay. So that's another big piece of your journey to teaching in public schools. And now, transfer and MTEL.
These are the two important steps in the process. First, we'll talk about transfer. Where to transfer for your bachelor's? We've been talking about the public school system, so that's where I'm concentrating on a little bit. State universities use the mass transfer option, which includes a simplified application, guaranteed admission, transfer scholarships, full transfer of credits. So you'll see that in your packet. We can go over mass transfer to the state universities, the four campuses of UMass, and the seven state universities like Fitchburg, Framingham, Bridgewater. So all the state universities are under mass transfer, and LEO and ECE are mass transfer degree options. So you're getting all those benefits. A lot of our students might go on to private colleges and universities, and I will help them look at those schools as well around the country to take a look at those programs, to look at the transfer of our credits where we don't have the agreements like in mass transfer. But we can certainly look at private colleges and universities with you. Local Massachusetts Transfer School options, that's in your packet, and it looks like this on the right side. We thought we'd include this for you because here we're talking about, gee, what schools could I do in the valley here that we primarily focused on. And on one side you'll see the non-licensure bachelor degree transfer options, and on the right side of this document you'll see the licensure universities and colleges and the types of programs they offer. So again, I could be looking at this sheet with you as you're looking at your options that Peggy and Kim had talked about. The MTELs, again, the Massachusetts Test for Educator Licensure, requires of candidates to pass all parts of the MTEL, particularly the second one. Part one is called the Communications and Literacy. And then part two is the subject matter knowledge. At GCC, when you're in our programs, we usually will suggest that you might take the communication and literacy before maybe the last two semesters. You get prepped, let's say in the fall, and maybe in the spring, that your last semester, you're actually taking the two tests, the two exams, communication and literacy. There are workshops, again, in your folder. UMass Amherst has told us that our students can certainly join the CLST prep workshops. I just printed out for you to show you that UMass offers to their students, because their students about sophomore year, like you'll be when you leave us, are preparing to take those CLSTs, the communication and literacy. And they will take one of these or more of these workshops. One is just an overview. You can do a multi-session. That's the one most students have done. They're 4 2-hour sessions that are usually done like in October, November, or February, March at the university, and the teacher there is really good at it and really helps you. You have a little spiel here about what goes on in that session, preparing you, giving you some confidence to take the CLSTs. There's also a Saturday workshop that's 6 hours long, and then the back sheet just tells you the information. This is on their website, and I usually just put MTEL prep on the UMass search bar to get in to see the dates. When they're being offered each semester. So again, we can work with you on looking definitely at these workshops. The other option is the MTEL site itself, which lots of students, if you're starting early, you can go on at any time. You don't have to wait till your last two semesters to prep and take the CLSTs. You can say, gee, let me look at the MTEL site. And I've been visiting it off and on and getting more used to it. And they just do a knockout job. But usually I'm going up to prepare, and I'll just scroll down here. You can also go to select your test. And here's one that I didn't even look at, but a student took it last semester, a practice test. And this is also in your folder, the interactive practice test. Just a little blurb about it. And she took it, and it's timed, and it gives you a sense that you're actually taking the communication and literacy. And then it gives you a little feedback on what you can improve on and what you didn't get. So she took it. She said it really helped her, even though she also took the UMass workshops. Because those tests are expensive. They're like $100 and $50 for the two. You can take them many times over, but the reading and writing portions are a little complex, and that's why most people are going to prep for them. But this is a nice backup. So this little thing here, do go in and take a look at it. She really enjoyed it. Here, you can just go and say, gee, let me look at the communication and literacy. What am I in for? And I found that they do a great job. The format, they're telling you what it's about, how many questions these two exams are, the timing, and you can go in and look at it, test dates, test centers, scoring, the fee, and test policy and prepare. And what I like about it is you can actually, let's see here, find a test near you, fee. You can actually go in and prepare. They really do give you sample test questions in reading and writing, and the open response questions. There's video and tutorials along with these kinds of sample tests, and there's even more practice tests for reading and writing. And down here, I think they even get into open response and additional resources. So I found this site to be really good. And you can get into it and practice and get questions, and you can bring them with you to the prep workshop, because it won't be the first time you saw it. That's why I like going to this site. Yes, all schools want the CLSTs up front first. Then the subject tests are taken at the university. And again, the subject tests are on the MTEL site. So you can preview that, and we can look at that with you. I often have students meet up with our department heads in education at UMass Amherst, at BayPath, at MCLA, or any school. We find out, we work close with the educators there, and have you meet with them and go over and talk to, like, Kim Drake at UMass Amherst Department of Education. I'm sending questions to her all the time about certain things, and she's updating me. And she says, yeah, have them come over and meet with us anytime to ask any questions. So I'll help you with all that kind of transfer. My last word on it is we're here to help you transition and plan all this. So do make appointments with all of us.
There's so much to think about and process. And so really that last slide that says you are not alone, you are not alone. The sooner you come and ask more questions and figure things out, the better. That's what we're all here to help you through this process. The fun part, now as I understand this, there's stickies involved. So what we're inviting you to do is actually get up and embody this process. Walk it through, just like live it vicariously for a little bit. Starting with that first question, what age group do I want to work with? So if you look around the room, we've got these big sort of posters up here, starting back there where it says age group and setting. Remember, those were the first two questions we got to think about. And then it moves on to what kind of degree do I need to get? Do I transfer? What's the certification? In other words, there's that MTEL stuff that was talked about. There's that 4-year. So you're going to get up and use your sticky and walk yourself through this process. So for those of you who are watching this video online and you're not here in the room today to participate in this walk around, there is a tool for you to use online that you can access that says, how do I get from here to there, your educational journey? And it will walk you through the different steps along here, and you can make your marks here, what decisions you make in terms of age group and setting, and sort of follow your pathway on here.